Namaste, everyone. Wish you all a very, very happy 4th United Nations International Day of Yoga. I know the whole universe is vibing with yoga, yoga, yoga. And the beauty is this yoga is something that has evolved thousands of years back, as many of you know. And yet, it stood the test of time. And it is prevailing, and it is penetrating more, and it has become a way of life for billions of people across the globe. So I thought today I will share some of my experiences, and specifically about a person, a teacher, a master, a yogi, who is conveying the true essence of yoga to the humanity. Her name is, of course, you know, Master Sunita. And my journey started 12 years back in this amazing path of yoga without realizing that it was a path of yoga. Hope you got it. I started the journey into it without even knowing that it was yoga. And that is the beauty of a true master. A true master like Sunita, who has become an embodiment of yoga, an epitome of yoga, can only do that. Can transmit the essence of yoga beyond techniques, beyond the postures which are very popular, beyond everything, but yet practices every aspect of yoga. In fact, her life started with yoga. There are two big frameworks of yoga for people who don't know. I know a lot of you know, you all probably know about yoga. The first discussion about yoga came very in a popular text of ancient wisdom called Bhagavad Gita, where Lord Krishna talks about four forms of yoga. In fact, what exactly is yoga? Yoga is to realize the oneness within and oneness with humanity. That is the ultimate essence of yoga. Everything else is in the middle. Everything comes in the process, in the path, but the ultimate goal is to realize that oneness, that subtlest of the subtle vibration of energy in you. And that energy is there in everyone and everything. That omnipresent, omnipotent, omniscient is yoga. Now, ancient wisdom has given four paths in Bhagavad Gita. For example, Karma Yoga, Bhakti Yoga, Jnana Yoga and Raja Yoga. In fact, if you actually look at the four, they represent four aspects of our existence. Four aspects of our existence. Jnana is the thinking part, the knowledge part. Right, we are thinking beings. And then the karma, which is the action, we are the action beings, doing, that is part of our day-to-day life. And then the third part is bhakti, which is the feeling, the devotion part. And then the fourth part is the Raja Yoga, the health and wellness part, and realizing that being. So our existence has thinking, feeling, acting and being. So these four paths are given in the ancient wisdom to realize that oneness. What I have realized in Master Sunita is she is an embodiment of all these four. She is not one of those who sits specially somewhere in a cave, doesn't come out into the world, nor she is some of those who is always giving lectures and teaching techniques, nor she is someone who is always devoted. She is a blend of all. She is in a family life, performing her day-to-day duties. She is an embodiment of the highest knowledge. What is the highest knowledge? Not the knowledge that is read in books. The knowledge of the highest pure divine self. That is the jnana, that is knowledge. She is an embodiment of that. And then her devotion, oh my goodness, I cannot even explain. Whoever comes to her, the way she cares, the way she serves actually, she never proclaims herself to be a master or a guru or a teacher sitting on a pedestal, nothing. Doesn't let anyone fall at her feet, doesn't let anyone put garlands on her, nothing. If you look at her when you come to her place, very simple, ordinary, but full of devotion, that serving. She feels everyone who walks into her door is a god, is an embodiment of God. She says that to me many times. She says, every time I say, oh my God, you are all believing in me, I feel like you are gods. See that? The devotion. And Raja Yoga, the training of the mind and body. She has been practicing the asanas from her childhood. Her day starts with that. Very early. She hardly sleeps. I told you many times. She hardly eats or sleeps. And again, we are going to come and touch upon those in a second. But see, she practices yoga asanas, which is very popular. She practices meditation, pranayama, the breathing exercises. When I say practices, it is not like a formal practices. She becomes that. She has become that. When she is in that, she is connecting to all these ancient sages and sages. When she is doing yoga, she is talking to Patanjali, the person who has created a fantastic framework for yoga, right? So that is what a true yogi is, who becomes an embodiment of all these four paths to realize that oneness beyond the mind and body, to realize that pure vibration of energy beyond the mind and body, which people call spirit, soul, atma, energy, whatever name you want to give. So that is what a true yogi is. And the best part is, whoever comes to her becomes that. They start to suddenly start thinking in that pure way. The pure knowledge starts to penetrate into their thinking process. So they think positive, they think pure, they think at a very higher state of consciousness for a greater goodness of humanity. They start to perform their actions. People have their goals and dreams. They perform their actions in a phenomenal way. And the devotion starts in them. Devotion to their children, devotion to their partners, devotion to their job. Devotion doesn't mean that devoted to a godly figure. Devotion in everything you do. And then they want to practice, they want to get up. Self-discipline becomes very natural for them. So not just Sunita, but everyone who comes to Sookshma also becomes, these four paths of yoga become seamless and effortless for them. And again, Sunita's beauty is, she never says, I created Sookshma. She says, Sunita is not Sookshma. Then what is Sookshma? Sookshma meaning, you know, it is micro, the subtlest of the subtle. The essence of yoga is to catch that subtlest of the subtle, which is there everywhere. It is here, 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 here in you, in the eyes you are seeing, in the ears you are hearing, in the smell that you are smelling. It is there, that knower is there. To catch that knower is yoga. Now, coming to the great saint Patanjali, who everyone talks about. What he had done is, Krishna has given a high level concept framework. Now this man said, no, the modern world is so chaotic, I got to kind of formalize and, you know, project management, we got to create a project plan for these guys, otherwise they're going to be all lost. So he created these 8 steps to get there. That's why it's called Ashtanga Yoga. 8 steps. First starts with Yama and Niyama. Yama is, how do you behave in the society? How do you behave with people in the society? What principles and values you carry when you're interacting with social beings in society? Next, Niyamas are simple rules and regulations for yourself. Being truthful, being honest, not stealing, being happy, all these things. So what Sunita had done is, there are so many rules and regulations in these Yamas and Niyamas. Of course, people don't have time. Even the greatest of the great yogis also don't have time to go through everything. So what she has done is, well, the modern life is so fast and so busy, so chaotic. So I got to simplify this for people to fit their current lifestyle. So what she has taken is 2 beautiful principles from those Yamas and Niyamas. First one is purity. Purification of body and mind. See, we take bath to clean our body. You agree, right? We all do that. But the purity she's talking about is more deeper. Inner purity, purity of thoughts. So when people come to Sookshma, the first thing that happens is cleansing. The first 4 sessions are cleansing. And the 4 sessions are very difficult. That's why Master says, take 8 sessions. Not because you have to give money for 8 sessions, or not that she wants to hold you for 8 sessions. Because she has seen this process for 40 years in her life, or more than that. Cleansing. Cleansing to purify the mind and body. That saucham, it's called saucha. That happens in Sookshma first. The next is ananda, bliss. No matter what, smile and be in that bliss. Because that bliss is right here. You who are watching this now can experience that bliss right now. Bring that smile. That ananda is there right here. But the problem is, this monkey mind and this intoxicated elephant called body gets us here and there, and we forget that it's here. Master says, everyone, Suman, it is right here, but we feel so far. So she has taken those two principles, remember dears again, purity and bliss, Saucha and Ananda, from those Yamas and Niyamas. And then of course asanas, yes, there are so many asanas, we know that, very complicated asanas, people are phenomenal in doing that. But again, what she has done is, yes, she can teach the two, but she has taken the essence of all that and created subtle things called Sookshma Kriya, subtle things, some things that she evolved by her own experience and practice, which are possible to be done by anyone from a 2-year-old to 90-year-old. Simple, subtle exercises, which you can do in 10 minutes, 5 minutes. There are some times when me or other people who are Sookshmas here, we don't have time, we are like 5 minutes how to recharge. You can do that. Anyone can do that, dears. That's why I say Sookshma is so simple. So asana she has taken, put that into Sookshma. Pranayama, breathing, of course, so many complicated breathings are there. But again, in Sookshma, very simple breathing exercises that you can do anywhere, anytime. I practice them, even at work I practice them. And my workplace, now it's become very big revolution, everybody practices that. They call it breathe and smile, you know that, right? BS formula. So, pranayama. Pratyahara, regulation of senses, very difficult actually. Not easy, you know how these senses are. They're like these wild horses running for this and that. Right? Eyes want to see dirty things, ears want to hear gossip, tongue wants to taste all junk food, nose wants to smell all useless things, skin wants the feeling of touch from useless things. These five senses. But what happens in Sookshma is, instead of that outer senses, we'll go into inner senses. That inner being, inner smell, inner hearing, inner seeing, inner feeling. Inner tasting. You don't have to eat. You can taste it. The saliva will start coming automatically without even touching the food. Just by thinking. That is inner knowing. That inner knowing makes pratyahara seamless, dears. You don't have to say, oh my god, I don't want to see bad things. Oh, I don't want to hear, like, you know, see the three monkeys closing these things. You don't have to do any of that. The outer senses shut down in Sookshma. Inner senses awaken. The inner senses awaken, finish pratyahara is happening. You don't have to say, now I have to do pratyahara. And the next, dharana, concentration, one-pointedness. When I came to master 12 years back, my mind was so scattered. I'm sure you can all relate to it. Everybody wants to do zillion things. So much of distraction, technology, this, that, going on. But here, dharana, in Sookshma, one-pointedness will start. That one-pointedness will become dhyana, which is meditation. And again, I have told you many times, this meditation is seamless, Sookshma, effortless. You come, you lie down, bliss. And meditation becomes a way of life. Meditation doesn't mean that you close your eyes, meditate, and you go out into the world and you are something else. No. You become meditation, you eating meditation, drinking meditation, cooking meditation, bathing meditation. Sunita says all this, all the time. Your life becomes meditation, you will keep experiencing that bliss. And then of course, samadhi. Samadhi, yes, of course, there are nirvikalpa samadhi, this samadhi, that samadhi, different stages of samadhi, which means transcendence to certain extent, right? Where your mind is completely still, you are going beyond the body and mind and becoming that one. There is only one, there is no body or mind, there is only one experience, and then you are experiencing that oneness with everyone. But that doesn't end there, dears. That experience translates to what is called samamaina buddhi, equanimity towards all beings, towards every situation, towards pain and pleasure, towards every situation in life. Non-dual. Duality to non-duality is samadhi, which means you are able to face any challenge in life. You will be one-pointed with your vision and you will remain in that bliss. Dears, this is yoga. Yoga chitta vritti nirodaha is what Patanjali said. True yoga is stillness in the mind. Now tell me, who can do that? Very difficult, I know. I heard ancient sages, Himalayan, some deep cave, some masters are there. How fortunate are we to have such an amazing, divine, pure master in our presence, in this chaotic world, to live with us and help us give the pure and true essence of yoga, dears. So my humblest salutations to a master who has redefined, revolutionized my life in a phenomenal way. And to all the ancient sages who have created a phenomenal platform which carried over thousands of years, which is helping us, which is the solace to all the chaos in the humanity, dears. Yoga, of course, I've spoken about the experiential part till now. There is an experimental part which all the universities are experimenting now. And they're finding phenomenal results with either yogasanas or breathing exercises or with meditation. They're talking about neuroplasticity, changes in the physiology, psychology. And of course, I've told always, so many healings we have seen in Sookshma from very complex illnesses. Not because of technique. Yes, there are techniques. But that healing energy and vibrations reformat the brain, reformats the physiology, reformats the psychology, and we have seen people heal from Crohn's, colitis, anxiety, depression, schizophrenia, bipolar disorder, rheumatoid arthritis, depression, diabetes, hypertension. 90% of the problems that we see in the world are all self-destructive. All that is happening here when they come to Sookshma is you're catching the pure self. Yes, some people come and they leave after one session, some people leave after two sessions. And like I said, the first four sessions are very difficult here because the cleansing is happening with the laser-like vibrations of the master. In that time, what we think is whatever is happening is because of the other person. So some people become very skeptical. I was very skeptical. I'm telling you very truthfully. After four sessions, I stopped coming to Sunita. I had a lot of false ego and a lot of fake emotions. So my dears, whoever has come to Sunita, whoever is coming to Sunita, whoever is planning to come to Sunita, be aware. The first four sessions, be patient. Fourth session is the make or break. This is true yoga, dears. All the eight, all the four essence merging together and becoming one, so that you blossom like that beautiful lotus. Thank you very much. My humble salutations again to everyone, all the yogis out there in the world. Wish you all a very, very happy 4th United Nations International Day of Yoga, and we will be streaming live from the UN itself very soon. Namaste. Thank you.